Well, my name's Marilyn Hawes, and I was a teacher in a primary school in Berkshire. I sadly discovered in 2002 that the head teacher, who'd been my best friend for 17 years and my boss for 10 years, was a paedophile. It went on to come out that he had actually sexually abused my three boys, along with many others across Berkshire during his career. So I thought, well, I've been on all the safeguarding courses. What did I miss? And then, having thought about it and studied it, researched it in that time before the court case and after, I realised what I'd missed, which is hugely significant and essential, is the behaviours, how they behave. That's your indicator. So I started writing lesson plans, basically, looking at a timeline of who these people are. At what point can you recognise it, identify it? Can you identify it? Yes, you can, because no one is born to abuse. You can see that inappropriate behaviour, even in high end of the primary school system. And then I went from there, can that person be cured, or is there any way forward? Looking at how they operate, the behaviours, I actually demonstrate that, and the team demonstrates it right through to the impact and the manifesting of those behaviours. So we cover child sexual abuse, child sexual exploitation, which is, of course, sexual abuse, but different again. We cover county lines, which has now come on the radar, online dangers, and we also deal and help redirect people to the right therapy for trauma that they're suffering. So it's the whole raft, the whole ball, really. I would say children these days, you're an elbow's nudge away from meeting something not very pleasant if you don't keep your wits about you. They are all at risk. I mean, if you're going to go hanging around, I say, if you're going to go in somewhere, there's six of you together, and you're going to go in some sort of restaurant cafe where young people hang out, and somebody your own age who you've never met before wants to sidle up to you and break into your circle of friends. Well, you don't want to cause a fight, but just sort of, oh, nice to meet you, bye-bye, thanks. And we're going, either move up, move away, pretend to take a call on your phone, have an exit strategy, because it isn't necessarily someone of an older generation. They've got to wise up to this, that it is very often someone maybe only a couple of years older. And the youngsters are really quite shocked when you tell them that. That, you know, that it could actually be somebody a couple of years up higher in the school. You just don't know. Grooming is like a covert romance. It's the precursor to the abuse. It's the schmoozing. It's building up a relationship of trust and love, shall we say. And so the trust around the guardians of the children, the friendship will include not just the child. This is why it takes so long. The trust and the it's like a snake working its way in, that it will, like, they will choose the child, and they will choose the child and hope that the carers, the parents, the guardians are perhaps not quite so solid as they should be. So they need to be quite vulnerable themselves, because the vulnerability thing is essential, really. Because if you've got people that are really strongly parenting, it's going to be very difficult to chip in there and get those people on side. And there's plenty of people whose relationships aren't working that they don't need to bother. But it will be the presence. It's like watching a romance back in Queen Victoria's day, if you like. It's like watching Downton Abbey. It takes a long time. It's not rushed. It's slowly, slowly, slowly catchy monkey, but it's also it slightly increases. So the presents become here, then a bit more, then a bit more. Then, oh, shall I take you out to, let's go down to some burger bar or something. And then it's something more. And then it's, oh, shall we go away for the weekend? Let me take your son away for the weekend. It's, you know, you're a bit hard up, you're a bit stressed at the moment. And it slowly increases. And once they've got their foot in the door, you know, it's very difficult, because, you know, and other people might say, people did with me, they said, it's a bit odd. No, he's always been like it. He was like it before these kids were even born. He's always been like it. You know, it is literally watching a romance slowly, but you will think, that's a bit odd. They're so generous. They know they're generous. They know they're very touchy-feely. And they know they'll take them on exciting trips and stuff. So that person becomes more exciting than their actual parents. So child sexual abuse is a child that's been emotionally, if you like, coerced. In the offline one, it goes on for a long time, the offline grooming. So this friendship has to be developed, this trust, this you have become my best friend. I'm the person that gives you all the gifts. I give you all the goodies. I maybe even give you more attention. I'm the person you can come to. I build up a covert romance in a way, really. And then, I mean, there's a wonderful document I've got that I take into prisons with me now called the Stages of the Fixated Paedophile. There are four definite stages. And when I looked at this document, I saw it 4 years ago, I actually went cold because it was my boys' lives. And it shows how it ramps up on each stage. And the lap sitting is in there. The wrestling games is stage four. It is the last part before it then goes into full-blown abuse and oral sex and all of that. So that's child sexual abuse, where there is this trusted relationship being built. With sexual exploitation, it's many people are going to rape you in one night. And there is a process of where you've got the hook. So you could be sat in the precinct somewhere. I will come up and talk to you. I'll be the same age as you. We chat, we laugh, we get on. You don't see me as a stranger because I'm the same age. You don't think stranger danger, so I'm the same age as you. And then maybe I offer you a cigarette after we've been talking for about an hour. That cigarette may well have drugs in it. I'm doing this from a real case study where this happened last year. 15-year-old girl, she woke up outside the town naked and raped after having a cigarette that was given to her by a girl she met in town, and it was drugged. You could be given a phone. Hey, yeah, Leo, we can chat more. Whoa, we can chat. You know, my dad's got this phone, blah, blah, blah. And we chat. What you don't know is there's a tracker in it. So the other guys can watch further up the pyramid, if you like. It's like an inverted pyramid. You've got the hook down here. Further up, you've got the coordinators, which are the cars, the taxis that are going to take you to a party. And at the top of that inverted triangle, you'll have probably 20 different men, three times older than you, and you will be raped by all of them. You'll be told, you're going with this man now, that man now, that man now, that man now. And you'll be given drugs and alcohol, and you'll be left basically a wreck, dumped maybe at 4 a.m, alive just, but in maybe a bus shelter, and you'll be fearful of saying anything, and your mum will then say, my daughter's gone missing, but you won't say because you're terrified. County Lines has been around for ages, but it's only really, people have only really started talking about it in the last 18 months, really, I suppose, but it's been known about for ages. It's been a use of established mobile phone networks from the big drug gangs, the big cartels in the main cities. But now it's escalated out into the urban towns, rural situations, market towns, seaside resorts, where people are far more naive and they don't expect it to be on their doorstep. It's also using those, and then in a cohesion with the rail networks and transport links. So the child has bought a rail ticket and they're put on a train. And they basically get off at 2 or 3 stops to meet someone. What they've done has been a drug mule, class A drugs, heroin and crack cocaine and cocaine for money in return. There were earlier this year 720 county lines across England and Wales. Then it went up to 900. There's now in excess of 1,000 lines that police now know about. And it does start by vulnerable people in the same way, being groomed in the street, chat away, ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Excuse me. Very often, I don't like to use the word middle class, but very often they're looking for clean skins. Clean skins are children who would not be given a second look by a police officer. So nice, well-balanced, pleasant children who are innocent. And they are approached. And what the children are missing is very often they will be approached by someone of the similar age. If you talked about strangers to children and young people generally, they think of someone my age or their father's age. This county lines, and the same with sexual exploitation, very often someone not so much older than them. It's quite clever, actually, because someone about your own age comes to talk up to you in a town centre, you'll talk to them. Because you don't think of them as a stranger. And those messages have got to be gotten there. Now, it would be very odd if maybe a 14-year-old boy rocked up at King's Cross railway station and said, I want a return ticket to York, please. Well, a bright person might say, why? What? Where do you get that money from? So the ticket will be bought for them, you see. And then they'll have some little packets where they get off. You get off at Stevenage, and then you meet someone and you do a swap. And then you get off at maybe Peterborough, then you do a swap. Then you get off at York, and then I'll meet you when you come back. Now, those swaps have meant you've picked up cash, hard cash, maybe 3,000 grand even. This is a £500 million a year business. Now, you try and get out of that, no way are you going to be ever. Even if you've done it once and thought, you know, this feels really weird, you're stuck. Your life will be under serious threat. 48% of acid attacks come from county lines where people have not complied. A lot of the stabbings, random stabbings, are to do with county lines. These people are serious intending criminals. They are dealing, they are dicing with death, literally. There have been any number of grammar school boys that have been targeted and gone along with it, and now they're lost in the system. They've gone down the county line route, lost into that system because they're terrified of losing their life. Domestic abuse absolutely links to sexual abuse, as does arson, as does animal abuse. Where there's domestic abuse, there's always somewhere going to be sexual abuse. It might be that the partner, the mother, is being raped as well as being bitten up and threatened. Now be the child. That child maybe never have been touched in any way. But what's that doing to its mental state when it's hearing its mother being thrown against a wall, threatened to be killed, and can hear its mother being raped? How's that child going to be when it comes into school the next day? You can do your own Romans homework. I'm not doing it. It's still traumatised. Be the child. Animal abuse, why? Because it's animals are vulnerable. And this is a game of power and control. I can take power. The power and control over the victim is as important as their desire. So taking that power, that's why they like the grooming. Having that power, making people, everybody work and filter through them. So it's like a puppeteer pulling everyone's strings so they're actually feeding into you and you control all of them. They like that. That's part of the play. It's part of the foreplay. It's the anticipation. They like all that.